Hello, friends. Welcome to Tell Us a Good Story. Today we have a very special guest, Coach Jeff Hartings. This gentleman has won a little bit of everything in his career as a professional football player, from high school to college to the NFL. He's won championships at every level. He actually won a Super Bowl with the Pittsburgh Steelers back in 2005. So we are honored to have him. He's got some great stories to share. So hope you enjoy today's episode of
Tell Us a Good Story.
The story of my life, I take her home. I drive all night to keep her warm in time. It's frozen.
All right, Steph. You've been very excited about this.
So excited.
You're so excited. A fellow Northwest Ohio graduate, right? So, ladies and gentlemen, our next guest has, I think, won every award imaginable, I think, except a Nobel Peace Prize. He's a husband, father of eight children, and the head football coach at Worthington Christian High School. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to Tell Us a Good Story, Coach Jeff Hartings. Thank you, Coach.
How are
you? It's my pleasure, and I hope I got a good story to tell.
Oh,
I think you're going to have plenty.
Here's a quick background of Coach's accomplishments. So he won a high school state championship at St. Henry, played on an undefeated team at Penn State. Were you co-national champions, by the way, that year?
No.
No?
I mean, we were New York Times national champions.
Okay.
I mean,
Was a two-time first-team All-American in college. Drafted in the first round of the NFL. He was picked number 23 by the Detroit Lions in 1996. Had an 11-year career in the NFL with the Lions and the Pittsburgh Steelers. He blocked for two future Hall of Fame running backs, Barry Sanders, Jerome Bettis, selected to a pair of NFL Pro Bowls, voted twice NFL Pro. I'm running out of breath here. He earned his Super Bowl ring with the Pittsburgh Steelers in 2005, scored a touchdown, and co-starred in a Campbell's Soup commercial with some of his Steelers teammates. On top of being a father of eight children and the head football coach at Worthing Christian High School. Did I leave anything out there, Coach?
That's enough.
Oh my goodness. That is amazing.
Like, you're amazing.
It makes me feel like, okay, Kevin, what are you doing with your life after reading that laundry list of accomplishments? So I know, Steph, you've been dying to ask. This is so Coach, exciting. This is really the main thing my wife wants to ask you. Go ahead, honey. Go ahead and start off the conversation.
Sure.
Let's talk about Mac football. Because people don't understand when I say, you know, I grew up watching football and they're like, oh yeah, I did too. I'm like, no. You don't, until you understand Mac football.
High school football.
Mac conference, high school football, you don't get high school football. What is your take on...
What was that like for you,
Coach?
Physical, very competitive. And, you know, podcasts nowadays, they're you know, worldwide, national and regional and everything else. And I think in Ohio is one of the top five schools for football. And the MAC conference is the number one conference. Might not be the best players in the state of Ohio, but definitely that conference is the most competitive, or one of the most competitive. We actually have a pretty competitive conference here in Columbus with Division I schools. But Division 7, 6, and 5, and for those that don't know, we have seven divisions in Ohio, Division 1 being the schools with 1,000 or more students probably in them, Division 7, 6, and 5 being schools with 100 or so kids in each class, and Parkway, St. Henry, Coatta, Marion are part of that conference. And it's just very competitive. And it really started back in the late 80s with my school, St. Henry, starting to win state championships. And we set the bar. And Coatta and Marion, I mean, Marion is a team that people nationally are chasing. They've had a New York Times article written on them. I think they've won nine out of state years they've won a state championship and been there 10 years in a row. And I'll tell you a little story. It's a short story. I'm at Worthington Christian. I'm trying to learn, get back to my roots of MAC football. So I'm meeting Coldwater's coach occasionally, talking to him and St. Henry's coaches. And we didn't make the playoffs last year. So I decided, well, I'm going to go to the Marion local Coldwater Cavalier state or not state. It was a playoff game. This was in 2018, actually, and just kind of revisit, see what that's like, see what the sidelines are like. Halftime, I was walking around the field, and there was a group of about 20, 25 Marion local kids, little, you know, kids, elementary school age kids on a little part of grass, probably 10 yards by 10 yards or whatever. And they were playing all out tackle football.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, mauling each other. Yes. One kid got hit in the gut and got dropped to his knees and was like walking around. And I took a video of it, sent it to my coaches, and I said, this is what we're missing, and I have no idea how to replicate it. So,
well, Coach, Steph was telling me about high school football in Northwest Ohio when we were dating and got married. Mm-hmm. And so her family took me to a Coldwater Versailles game. Okay. And during this particular year, Coldwater was ranked first in Division VI. And I think Versailles was maybe Division V, ranked number one. And so I went to the game and I was shocked by the turnout. Mm-hmm. Like literally these towns shut down for the football game, and the 50-50 drawing was over $10,000. And so the take home, and I'm like, Steph, my high school is like $200, $250, let alone they've got to probably walk this guy to his car with security because this guy's pulling home over 10 grand in the 50-50 drawing at these games. I was blown away by how big of a deal
the
it was.
The athletic department is too. The school is getting the other 10,000.
Yes, yes, yes. So,
you know, that would help out a lot. So it's, you know, it's community pride. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm trying to develop this at Worthing Christian. We're a private school. It's tough. It's tough to replicate the competitive toughness, physical, mental, and it's tough to replicate the community pride. There's a lot of it.
Yes.
You can hear that in Steph. She's very proud of the community that she went. I'm very proud of my community, and it's a great part of a great area, a place to grow up.
Mm-hmm. So when you graduated from high school, of course, you're on a state winning championship team. You played, I think, with Bobby Hoying, I believe.
Yes.
Who ended up being a starting quarterback at Ohio State and ended up going to the NFL as well. But what I'm curious, what led you, Coach, to end up at Penn State versus like any other school back then?
Well, I love Notre Dame, and they weren't recruiting me, so
okay.
That was easy. I did not like Ohio State at all, and they weren't really recruiting me until the end. And I went to a couple Penn State camps with Bobby and some other guys. I love the college, and I love the idea of playing with Joe Paterno. And I read a book about their Heisman Trophy winner, John Cappelletti, whose brother had died of cancer. And I forget what the book was called. Something for Joey, I think.
Okay.
It was called. And I just, in the book, I realized that with Coach Paterno, it was more than about – his number one priority was growing men and doing it with honor and doing it the right way. And so it really wasn't a very difficult decision for me. I wanted to have an opportunity to win a national title, opportunity to go to the NFL, and I felt like those two things could be accomplished there if I was good enough, and it worked out well.
What was he like, Coach Paterno, behind the scenes, right? Because mm-hmm. I guess you see him on TV. You see
no
the fault.
Headset.
Yeah, no headset. Mm-mm. Pants rolled up.
Old school.
Old school guy. Mm-hmm. What was – and you got him when he was in his prime as well. So what was he like as a coach, right, back yeah. in the day, back in the 90s?
Intense.
Was he?
Very intense. Very driven. Very – Nick Saban, like we're all watching Nick Saban right
yes.
now. Bill Belichick, probably not as dry as Bill Belichick, a lot more relational. I was intimidated, I'm not gonna lie, for 5 years. I don't even think I had five conversations with him
really?
In 5 years. I mean, you know, one-on-one conversations
right.
with him. You know, I got in trouble on campus. I'll tell you this little story. I got in trouble on campus and on a weekend, and I was in his office on Monday morning, and man, I was nervously awaiting my opportunity to go in there. I sat down. I didn't know what to expect. And he looked at me and he said, Jeff, this is always probably I think I was a freshman my first year there, first semester. And he said, Jeff, you have a great opportunity to be a great player and a great person at Penn State University if you don't mess it up. So don't mess it up. And I was like, that's all? And I walked out, and I was like, it still gives me chills. And I was like, that's all he needed to say. And, you know, from that point forward, it was a great moment because I kept myself clean. I had the right friends, and he inspired me just in those little words right there to pursue excellence for the rest of my career there.
Any memories that you can think of with school, with locker rooms or your best game or anything like that you can think of that just whenever you think of college football, you always think of that one game or that one experience that you had?
Man, you know, athletes say they remember the times that they messed up more than they remember the times that they succeeded. Mm-hmm. And I hate to say when you ask that question, the first things that come to mind are, you know, we played Miami and we lost. And then I'll get to the good memories.
Yeah.
Miami, we had hoped to win a national title. Here I am. I'm a freshman coming on campus, and I don't even know if I can play with these guys because I was a small town saint. Steph can tell you, man, small town. Back in that day, no cell phones. I was just telling somebody the other day, I'm like, all we got was the Daily Standard. That was the local news.
Yeah.
I didn't even know anything about the outside world, really. Didn't even have ESPN at our house, so I didn't get to see much of that. So I was really intimidated, not sure if I could compete, but I was going to give it 100% effort. My first year, I realized quickly, like, wow, I can compete with these guys. I'm pretty athletic. I'm not big enough. I blew my knee out, for lack of a better way to put it.
Man.
Redshirted. It was a blessing at that time because I put on 25 pounds and I was ready to roll as the next year went in. And we're playing Miami. I'm playing against Miami Hurricanes. Jimmy Johnson had went to the Dallas Cowboys by then. It was surreal. Like, I couldn't even believe it. And fourth and one, and I forgot to pull. I didn't pull, and I was supposed to. And Jesse Armstead, great linebacker, 10 years. He blows the play up. We lose the game. The next year, Michigan, first and goal from the 1 yard line. We don't score. We lose the game, lose a Big Ten championship. And then the following year, I'm not saying this because I'm living in Columbus and, you know, but all the Ohio State fans remember in 94, blew out Ohio State. And that was a pretty phenomenal experience. I'm playing against Bobby Hoying, my friend. We have a lot of people from St. Henry coming in and nobody could have predicted that. Even, you know, we could say that, oh, we knew we were that good, but it was one of those days, paternalisms. We weren't as good as we thought we were, and they weren't near as bad as everybody was telling them they were.
Now, when you say you blew them out, it is 63 to what? 14, I think?
Yeah, 60. Yeah, but it was 45-7 at halftime. It was like,
oh,
we scored every time we touched the ball. 42-7 probably at halftime.
Gosh. And I was telling Steph when we were looking at, like, the teams you had been on, that team – on offense, you had 5 first-round draft picks, 2 second-round draft picks. I mean, loaded with future NFL guys. I was blown away, like, how good that team was that you were on at Penn State. That was pretty incredible.
Yeah. Great experience.
So when you moved on to the NFL, of course, you got drafted by the Lions. I'm curious if you have a good Barry Sanders story, because seeing that you play with Barry Sanders when he's MVP, but you also were there when he retired at such a young age. And so I was curious if you have a good Barry Sanders story, because he wasn't a real high profile guy. He didn't do a lot of interviews, didn't do a lot of media. And so I was curious if you had a good memory of him.
Yeah. I think first of all, as far as Barry goes, he was introvert, just not comfortable with all the attention. Didn't think the attention for being a football player was a big deal. You know, it was at the beginning, in his defense, it was at the beginning of national media. Once again, you know, I'm not trying to age myself, but in the 90s, you know, you weren't taught how to do interviews and you didn't have your social profile,
right?
I guess, whatever the media profile like guys have nowadays. But I still think Barry Sanders would be a humble guy. It was amazing playing with him. A great guy. I remember the work ethic that he had in practice when the defense was out there and the offense was on the sideline. He'd be running, conditioning, and getting ready. But, you know, the best thing I can say, my best story I can tell, true story, I'm a rookie. I signed late and finally get on the team. And maybe about week 9 or 10, first day, you know, getting in the huddle, I'm looking around. Barry Sanders, like, once again, this is surreal. This is unbelievable. had the could have got drafted by anybody, but I'm 3 hours from home. My parents can come. I'm with right. Barry Sanders. I watched him. Greatest running back ever in college, some people say. And by the end of that year, I had you're never healthy in the NFL. So I had had a separated, basically like torn rib cartilage. Our left tackle or right tackle was done for the year. And so it was me playing with torn rib cartilage. Oh. Our right tackle was an undrafted rookie. And we're going against San Francisco 49ers, and they're just coming off Super Bowl victories. And Barry is going after their league rushing title, which he doesn't really care about anyways, but we want to get it for him. And we're in San Francisco on a Monday night, and I'm thinking – and we're going against the best D-tackle in the league, by the way, on my side. And I'm thinking, man, this is going to be a rough day. And it was, like, probably one of the worst – it was worse. It was bad because of my injury and everything, and he was very good. But there was one play in particular where Barry did his thing where he goes all over the place. Like, I basically didn't block my guy. I don't know if anybody did. He did like three spin moves, and I was on like the 50-yard line. He's down. We started on the 30, so it's like 70-yard touchdown run. I'm jogging at the 50. I'm watching him make guys. I can see it in my brain right now. And I said to myself, this is like a stinking video game. Like, somebody's operating him. And you know how people you hit the button and he spins and makes a guy
right,
hit, you
right.
hit another button. I'm like, I'm playing it. I'm just in Turbo. A video game here with this guy.
I'm not going to block my guy. I'm just going to watch him spin, reverse, turbo button, gone.
Turbo, that's right. I don't even play video games, but I've seen people playing. That's what
so
it looked like.
You talk about torn rib cartilage. Yes, that was a Monday game, but you know, think if you played on a Sunday or. What was your body like come Monday morning when you woke up? Could you get out of bed?
I loved football. My second year in the NFL, I stopped thinking that I could be 100% healthy. In college and high school, I kind of really felt like I went into games, felt 100%, did the body check, and was like, yeah, everything feels good. There was a point in the NFL my second year, I kept pursuing, like, man, sooner or later, I'm not going to have something nagging. And then I just was like, forget about it. Every single week, you're going to have something nagging you. But adrenaline does amazing things. Competitive spirit, competitive yeah. drive does amazing things. I think as years have went on, we're seeing it right now with the death of Kobe a couple days ago. The pursuit of excellence that he had last night, I was watching something. The amount of effort that athletes put into getting out there on game day, you know, for people to criticize that is really foolish. We put a ton of effort into just getting better at our skills, but also getting ourselves to feel right. And there's no days off. I think it's built tremendous amount of character. In high school, college, NFL, it doesn't matter where you're not calling in sick,
right.
like a lot of people do in the general employment world, job world. You know, football players, basketball players, athletes in general, you don't call and have days off. You're training all the time. That helps you in life.
Right.
Builds character.
When you're on the line, all right, and you're getting ready to block and you look up at the defense coming at you, is there a player that you're like, oh.
Not good.
This isn't going to be good.
This is a big dude.
Yeah. Like, you just see the eyes and, like, the spit coming out. Like, they just want you.
Yeah, well.
Like, who is that, like, you mentally think of? You're like, oh, that guy, he's going to come for it.
Yeah, well, first of all, I don't want to sound like a coach, but I can't have that prey attitude. That's a prey attitude. I'm not predator attitude. You got your face, your eyes are forward, you're focused, you're on task. And, you know, for me anyways, you know, I felt like I could block anybody if I had
That's
the right
awesome.
Technique, right. the right mental state of mind. And, you know, thankfully I could. I God-given ability and skill and coaches. But actually our practices were the toughest in training camp. Casey Hampton, you know, hopefully he'll be a Hall of Famer someday. He has several Pro Bowls and he was a nose tackle, and that guy, he knew our snap count, so that didn't help.
Oh, true. Yeah.
One guy. And John Randall, he's a Hall of Famer.
I remember
from
him.
Minnesota Vikings. He was amazing. And Bryant Young was amazing from the San Francisco 49ers. He did have one of those excruciating injuries where he broke his lower leg, and so he wasn't quite as good after that, but he was still an amazing player. So there were definitely guys where, you know, you knew how to prepare a little bit extra. I only weighed 290. I was going against 330 pound guys that, you know, probably could be tight ends, or probably were tight ends or linebackers. And so it was fun, but, you know, I got put on my back one game, and ironically, it was the best game I ever had because I let up for one play, got put on my back right by Big Ben. I blew his knee out.
Oh, man.
And that woke me up, and I played the best game of my career.
So moving on to the Steelers, right? So I think in 2001, you signed a free agent contract with Pittsburgh, which ended up being a pretty good decision, Coach, quite honestly.
Wasn't even my decision.
That worked out well. But you end up winning a Super Bowl, right, in 06. I'm the question I have about that, right, because we could talk about the Super Bowl all day long, but I'm curious when you and your team actually won it, what that experience was like, because did it meet your expectations of winning at the highest level possible and what that meant?
Yeah, 100% met my expectation, 100%. By then, I'd given my life to Christ. I went into the NFL. Just heard somebody talking about it last night with Kobe Bryant and how, you know, when you're a young athlete, to get to that level, you really do have to be almost singular focused and almost selfish. And I was. I broke up with my current wife. Thankfully, we got back together. But in high school, I wanted to focus 100% on making it to the NFL. And that damaged a lot of relationships. And when I was in Detroit, went to a Bible study, long story short, went to a Bible study, heard the word of God. And I was like, wow, never even knew I could have a relationship with God and how that would change my life. Not only did it change my life as a husband, I was a new father and I was very nervous about that. But it changed my life with regards to my profession and playing football. Kind of, it lifted all of the expectations that coaches had and even myself, and just had me playing for the satisfaction of God, which is really simple. Just have a great attitude, concentrate on your job, on your task. You have a responsibility. It is a profession, and give 100% effort. And so by the time I got to the Super Bowl, and by the way, lost a couple championship games, that was tough.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, that was very tough. That gave me a different perspective also. So, you know, year 10, I'd been through a lot. I went to the game. I wasn't nervous about it. I was excited about going out there to try to win the game. We won the game. It was an amazing, amazing feeling of accomplishment. Just imagine, you know, since I was 10, 11 years old, I wanted to win a Super Bowl.
Right.
So I'm 34 years old, 23. If you can imagine wanting something for 23 years of your adult thinking and adolescent thinking life, that's what you wanted, and then you finally get it. It definitely met my expectations. Did not let me down.
That's good. Well, where's your Super Bowl ring at? Do you wear it much?
Hardly ever wear it. It's in the basement somewhere. Another thing I'm safe. Good luck carrying the safe out, but no, it's too bad. I only bring it when I'm doing speaking engagements, or I want to show kids or something like that. I'm kind of an introvert. I'm like Barry probably, you know, I don't like the center of attention, so I don't bring it out too much, but if you ever want to see it, I can show it to you. I guess I should have brought it. I could have showed it.
Moving in, Coach, into retirement. I'm curious. So when you retired from the Steelers and the NFL, quite honestly, you could have done anything you wanted to, mm-hmm. right, in life. What led you, Coach, to end up moving your family to Columbus, Ohio, and at that point, I think, becoming an assistant coach at Worthington Christian?
Yeah, there's one stop in between. I mean, actually, a couple, really. I had become a Christian. Somebody, the guy who led me to Christ in Detroit, had invited us to be part of a church plant in Salt Lake City.
Okay.
Of all places. So I always dreamed of living in the West. And so we moved out there and helped plant a church out there the last 3 years of my football career. We'd live out there in the off season and go back to Pittsburgh to play the season. I didn't know how much longer I'd play. I had a really bad knee. We won a Super Bowl. I got very involved with an inner city ministry, raising money for an inner city ministry, doing after school programs, sports and academics, and then summer school for over 200 kids. They were just getting started, really. Now it's very big, working with over 1,000 kids. It's pretty amazing. So we moved back. We actually stayed in Pittsburgh when I retired for 8 years, and I did inner city ministry, raising money. And for 6 years of those eight, actually doing after school ministry. That was my occupation.
Okay.
I was in ministry full time, doing all these programs, after school and in the evenings. And then we felt like God was really leading us to get closer to my family and my wife's family in Coldwater and St. Henry. Columbus was the city that was closest to that area and wouldn't be so much of a culture shock for our kids at that point.
Right.
And so we decided to move here, decided to go to a private school, a Christian school, to be part of that ministry. I didn't know what God was going to do, really. My motto really was, doesn't matter where you live, it's how you live. And wherever I live, he can use me. So I started assistant coaching and then became the head coach. And the head coaching job has, I've just loved it, taking it on 100%. I substitute teach when they need me or when I want to. But most of the time I'm just coaching. I'm actually going back to school right now to learn more about coaching and just athletic director leadership. So I've been the head coach here for 3 years. I feel like we've developed a ministry with our team here.
That's awesome. So I have a friend who has been part of your Warrior Youth Football League. And one reason that I wanted to have you on, quite honestly, and this worked out well because you emailed me something the other day about what I was going to ask you about. But he was telling me kind of about the process and the structure you have with your youth football league. And if you don't mind, I want to get on a soapbox here because quite honestly, when I go to – now, Grant, we have three little kids, right? So 8, 4, and 1. But over the years, Coach, we've gone to several games, nieces and nephews, whether it's playing football, baseball, volleyball, whatever. And I'm always observing coaches, right? And I typically leave feeling frustrated and disappointed because there's so many coaches out there who like attention, make things about themselves, maybe like to hear themselves talk, and they're, even at the little league level, they are screaming and berating officials and then even yelling at kids as well. And there's been situations where I've seen, and it just like breaks my heart because, and I want you to kind of talk about your process, but there's been situations where I will see a coach berate a kid. And I keep thinking, like, do you know that kid's background? Do you know his, what his home life is? Do you know that he may be getting verbally abused by his dad at home, right? And you yelling and screaming at him is not helping, right? There are times where a kid may need a hug, right? Or need someone to say, hey, I value you. I cherish you. We appreciate you being part of our program. And I appreciate what my friend told me about your youth program because it sure seems like that program and what you have structured with how you train your coaches and mentor athletes is you use athletics, you use football as a platform to mentor kids and make an impact on kids at that age. And so can you talk a little bit about what you do process-wise, structures to impact youth?
Yeah, definitely. So it's a work in progress. For those coaches out there, you know, there's probably hopefully a lot of coaches listening. You know, there's guys that don't even get it at all, but there's hope because I didn't get it at all either. And then, you know, first of all, I learned about Jesus Christ and the impact that he can have so that you can actually share that love with the kids that you're coaching. And then secondly, I learned about this transformational coaching versus transactional coaching. And I'm really surprised how many coaches have never heard of these terms and never even thought about the idea of that. And, you know, a lot of times they're not even like, oh yeah, I've heard about something like that, but I haven't heard those terms, but they haven't even thought about it this way. And transactional coaching is where you're a coach because you love the game and you're interested in winning and losing and you're part of the team and we're all working together and the objective is to win the game.
Right.
And so you're going to coach the skills and when they don't perform and they're not doing what you're asking them to do, what you believe is going to help you win the game, you typically respond with frustration you typically get frustrated and then respond by being angry, and then you use the language towards those youth that is tearing them down instead of building them up. When you're a transformational coach, you look at this as an opportunity to build character in the kids. It's just another educational opportunity. You're growing these kids, you're mentoring them, and you're building character in the kids. And your focus is on and loving the kids that you're coaching. So if you really think about and have that focus, where my job is to love the kids.
Right.
Now, obviously, you're building skill in the kids, the football skills, the basketball skills, or whatever it is. You're working very hard on the schemes, but you have a totally different perspective. Totally different perspective. I still feel like I'm part of the team. We want to win the game. That's our goal. But the way that I do about it is, you know, I have certain things, certain mantras or kind of slogans, if you will. One of them is energy. You know, be enthusiastic, be encouraging, and give relentless effort. And we're always talking about encouraging our kids and looking at in the weight room. I'll give a good example that I've learned this year. Even instead of going by and looking at a kid that's doing 135 pounds for 10, and you feel like he could do 175 for 10, the typical way of coaching, I think, is that's all you can do. Come on, man, put more weight on there. Instead of saying, man, great job getting those 10. You look like you could get more. Next time, maybe you ought to think about putting more weight on there.
Right.
And, you know, it gives me chills saying that because I'm learning about this way of coaching. And you can just imagine, you just built that kid up. You just told him how great of a job he did. And eventually, it's like everything in life. It's like that basketball player shooting 500 shots a day, and he's going to get better at shooting. Well, as a coach, you got to practice this way of coaching every single day. You got to focus on that. And there's a lot of materials out there I can share that they can read. But I would say the number one thing is that your focus is changing the character and building kids up. And like you said, recognizing how many things are going on that are tearing them down at home. 50% divorce rate. Obviously, I always tell my kids, 50% divorce rate. How many happy families you think are out there? Not
right.
Very many. 50% are divorced, 25% are just hanging in there, and 20% aren't happy. So, you know, 5% of kids are in a happy household. The least that we can do as coaches is try to create a fun, happy environment, and we can build them up and we can teach them a different way. And I think there's a lot of coaches out there that want to do that and just are looking for information to do that. And so I can share some information, like
yes.
I said.
So we can put that in our show notes.
I'm in a group of coaches on my staff that we're all holding each other accountable. And, you know, I see things that they're doing. It's like, oh, man, that was really good. That was a great example of how they taught that. You know, that how they installed defensive game plan. I like his enthusiasm. I got to do a better job of that. And I think it goes vice versa. And then sometimes you see things, you're like, ooh, man, I don't think that got that kid very motivated. You shouldn't have used that language. The words that we used and how we say it and who we say it to, and I was even reading today, when we say it are very important.
It's critical. Well, Coach, we want to thank you so much for your time. I absolutely love this. Steph and I, before you called in, were like, Steph, we got to try to keep this to not be 2 hours because we
yes.
could totally probably talk to Coach Hartings forever.
We could.
But,
we absolutely could.
But we want to thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us and tell several good stories. So thank you, Coach.
Yeah, my pleasure. We'll do it another time.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Listeners, if you like what you just saw, like what you just heard, please go to iTunes, go to YouTube, and subscribe, rate, review this podcast. That's the only way we'll be able to continue to produce this. Where else can they go, Stephanie?
They can go to kevinandsteph.com. That's all I know, though. So, is that it?
You crushed it.
Yes, crushed it.
Thank you, listeners. The story of my life, I give a love, I spend a love until she's broken.